Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show, to Raw Babes 101. We have the most incredible guest here today. Please welcome Jenn. Jenn is also known as Rozette. This is her performer, her stage name. Jenn is an incredible musician. She is a singer, songwriter, vocal coach, pianoer. And I love that you said pianoer. Because I don't, who wants to say, what is it, pianist?
Yeah.
Like, we might as well just say penis.
Every once in a while, someone will write me and be like, you know, the actual word is pianist. And I'm like, I'm aware.
You're like, I've been doing this for however long I've been doing this.
Yes.
And I'm pretty sure I know. And Jenn is also an incredible public speaker. And does incredible one-on-one coaching. So I and Tiffany got to have a sneak peek into your world and what you do at the MYM conference. And like, first and foremost, Jenn, your energy, like I was drawn to you the moment you opened your mouth. You are so freaking powerful and you captivate the room. We were in the VIP for all of you guys that weren't there and don't know. And it was like, it's basically kind of like a class. And Jenn comes on stage and her energy just owned your energy. I'm talking like third person, owned the room. And then your voice and you started singing, it just rippled chills through my body. I was like, anyways, I'm not going to say too much more because I want to get into you and how you got to where you are and learn about your background. And also, welcome to the show. Thanks for saying yes.
Well, thank you for having me. And thank you for saying all that you did, because sometimes as a presenter, a performer, or coach, all of the hats that I wear, sometimes it's easy to be cut off from how you are received, because we are of service, right? As an entertainer, as a speaker, as a coach, my job is to be of service to people. So, thank you for reflecting back to me, what it, you know, that experience. That's really great to hear.
Yeah. And, you know, when you were on stage and then singing and performing, I was like, oh, this is such a nice treat. But then when I started to learn about you and what you actually do, when we were singing, like you guys, Jenn had us all singing, men, women, all ages, whether we knew how to sing or not. It was the takeaway of my weekend. I'm not kidding you. Like, what you got us to do and to be able to break down notes and our voice and to learn about how we talk and whether we are up here or down here, it's just such a gift. Like, it's so unique. I've never seen anything like it, what you do.
Oh, well, thank you. I think that when we are really in love with a particular topic, it's really easy to share that love with other people. And I wake up every day thinking about the voice, and I go to bed every day thinking about the voice. So when I get to stand in front of open-minded, open-hearted people who really just want to learn about themselves and take themselves to all the places where they are the most alive and they are the most curious and they are the most themselves, it is a real gift right back to me to be able to talk about and share about the thing that I'm so excited about. So I'm glad that it was effective when you were in the room that day.
Yeah, there was, every single person was just in awe. And then when you were going around the room, getting people to actually sing out loud, that's just another level of tapping into confidence and facing fears. So yeah. Powerful.
I really appreciate that particular offering, when people accept that offering because I do understand, even though I use my voice pretty confidently and pretty readily, I truly do remember and hold in my heart how big of a leap that is for most people. And we, even if we talk confidently, singing is talking on fire.
Right.
So when we are called, and we all know that public speaking, there, what is that? What is that statistic or that saying that people talk about how, you know, there's a chunk of people that would rather, they would literally rather be in the casket than speaking at the funeral. Like
Ruth.
Public speaking is a really, really, really big, big, bold move for people. And so too is singing. So that offering that I do with people where I go around the room and people, some people may know each other, some people may be complete strangers, but I know how big of an ask it is to be put on the spot in a silent room of people holding space and staring with their heads and their hearts and their eyeballs all at you.
Yeah.
For you to do something that isn't necessarily your specialty. But my argument is that yes, it is. Yes, it is. We all use our voices every day. We do. That's how we relate and connect to the world. So yes, I totally hold space and respect how big and bold of an ask it is of people. But my calling is to remind people that their voices is something they are very familiar with. And the more they can step into that open space, the more they will be reminded how capable they are and how much unutilized stuff there is to tap into in their own body. I love that.
Wow. So powerful. So cool. I would like to circle back and talk more about your singing and about even just tips and tricks and all that, but I'd really love to know your story. How did singing enter into your world? What were you like as a kid growing up? What was your life like before?
Thanks for asking.
Yeah.
Thanks for asking. There barely feels like a before.
Right.
But you know, every time someone asks me this question, there's this little voice in my head that says, don't talk about bullying because it almost feels like a boring trope.
Mm-mm.
But the truth is that, we moved when I was 7 years old. We moved from one small town in Alberta called Vegreville to another small town in Alberta called Drumheller. And though my family was reasonably well known in this tiny town of Vegreville, and I was a very happy kid. I had a really beautiful family.
Yeah.
I have a really beautiful family. And my parents, I believe in hindsight, did a really good job of allowing my sister and I to be kids. I don't know if that means anything to you, what I just said, but I think that there's a lot of quick growing up that can happen. And my parents, particularly my mom, made sure that we were kids as long as possible.
I love that.
And I'm really grateful for that. But along with that, when we moved to a new town and I didn't know anybody and was quite innocent and childlike and happy, that doesn't always go over.
Yeah.
You know, people who are open-hearted sometimes are, people don't know what to do with them. And the world is kind of harsh sometimes. So I was very bullied.
Okay.
Through my youth.
Was that when you moved? You say it started to happen?
Yeah, before I moved, I was actually quite, I guess for lack of better words, I mean, how popular can a seven-year-old be? But I mean, happy. You know, people liked, the teachers liked me and, you know, things were good.
Yeah.
But when we moved, the energy was really, really different. And I did not know how to process the negativity coming at me. It was unfamiliar for my parents and for myself. And the bullying was, you know, it got so far as to be spit on and stuffed in lockers.
Wow.
And yeah, and in hindsight, I'm kind of like, oh, that's really yucky that that happened to her. And even though her is me, you know, when you're an adult, you look back at your kind of child self and you're like, oh, that's really harsh.
Yeah.
That's really harsh. But again, I'm really lucky that I had such a wonderful family. And my mom, by the time I was 14, Still being bullied, but holding my own as much as you do when you have a good family. And I really loved school. I really loved learning. I feel a little bit different about the education system as it stands now, but I really did love school and I did love learning, and I think it provided a place to go stuff. It's good.
Yeah.
But
What did
mom,
Sorry, I was going to
no.
ask, what did you do? What was that brought you so much joy? And like what you're saying, going to school and bullied, like what did you do kind of for an out with that, or like to feel safe and protected during that time?
Well, I think again, I really leaned into my family, but I really loved dancing. Dancing was something my mom saw that I liked, and she put me in ballet. But unfortunately, when we moved, the bully seeped into dancing too. So dancing was something I eventually moved on from because it just was, bullying at school and then bullying at dance just was a bit much. But what she did notice was how much singing I did. And what she was actually witnessing in hindsight was something that I share with my clients and those in the audience often, which is that if you want to immerse yourself in music or singing or any skill really, you kind of have to give yourself permission to obsess the way a kid does when they love something. So my mom heard me listening to probably Mariah Carey singing the same bar 16 times. I would just rewind it and did she breathe like, or did she breathe like, or did she breathe like, so that kind of obsession, when you see somebody who's skilled at something, the chances are very high that they obsessed about it. And probably some ways in a healthy way and probably some ways in an exaggerated way, but that's how we become really, really knowledgeable. So mom saw me singing and insisted that she try and put me in singing lessons, which this was obviously many, many years ago. And we lived in a small town, so really there was only one coach that was working very seriously as far as my mom could see, and that coach coached classical music, or yeah, like more opera or classical music, which most young people aren't terribly interested in.
I was like,
They're not.
oh, I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's kind of when I'm imagining we're in the same decade at least. Our birth years are in the same decade at least.
I'm 86.
I'm 82.
Okay.
So when we were young, that's kind of one of the lovely things that have happened with social media and the TikToks and all the craziness, is it has made coaches available that aren't as I don't want to say aren't as academic, but aren't as, people still somehow believe that classical music, some people still believe that classical music is the only like scholarly way to learn music. I don't feel like that, but that definitely was in the 80s. That was kind of the vibe, especially in a small town. So my mom called up this vocal coach and she said, "Sorry, I'm full." And my mom, as all crazy awesome moms do, said, "No, you have to audition my daughter," which is kind of embarrassing and even in hindsight, but that's what mom love is.
That's right. I
So
love
she
that.
so she insisted, and this coach did audition me, and as the story goes, made space for me. But again, as much as classical music was stimulating and interesting, and learning a bit of German and learning a bit of Italian and French was very interesting, I was still obsessed with Mariah Carey and The Little Mermaid and Sarah McLachlan and Celine Dion and Whitney Houston. And those stylizations are quite frowned upon in classical music. So
Interesting.
every time my coach stood up to fill her coffee or go to the washroom, I would sit down at the piano and start trying to understand chords and understand things. And so, needless to say, that perhaps was a year that I studied with her. But I very quickly realized I wanted to write songs. I wanted to play the piano. I didn't really want to sing Gretchen am Spinnrad. I wanted to sing my diary. I wanted to sing my diary. So even though I'm really grateful, because I think that filled me with the confidence, filled me with some confidence that I had some skill. It's definitely not the direction I wanted to go. So really, really grateful mom saw that and pushed me. Really, really grateful the coach took me and that I had some time to have some structured learning,
Yeah.
but quickly wanted to move back on to contemporary pop music.
Yeah, rightfully so.
Yeah. So that's how I found my way to music in the very early years.
Wow. So, how old do you think you were when you were with the coach?
It was 14.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so even before then, your voice, you just started to be so obsessed with Mariah Carey and all that. So were you just like singing in your room and singing with your friends and just singing, just never stopped?
Yeah, and I was just really curious. You know, when you look back at your child self, have you ever heard the saying, the way we do one thing is the way we do everything? You ever heard that?
Ooh, I don't know that if I have.
It's really
Tell me.
true. Yeah, if you kind of even think about the way you eat, the way you treat bedtime, the way you
Okay.
look at work, the way you manage your friendships, there's often a really common thread. I see it a lot with my clients, the way they learn or the way they process when something is working or the way something isn't working. We kind of have a mode, a lens with through which we see the world. And
Truth.
sometimes it's really handy and sometimes it's like not so handy, but it's our lens all the same.
Right.
So where was I going with that as a kid? Yes. So I would obsess about details that probably to the average person were like the kid's a little bit intense, you know, about it. But now the way I coach and the reason I think some of my content is so appealing to people is because it is incredibly detail oriented in a
True.
really palatable way. But
Yeah.
the details are what make art sound like art. I think one of my most passionate topics, you know, people will say, well, I want to sing and I want it to sound really passionate, so I'm going to close my eyes and feel everything and just go deep and it's all going to sound great and be great. And while I think it's important to go inward and to give yourself freedom to explore, if you're trying to sound a certain way or pursue it in any way, the beauty for the listener or the audience comes from the purposeful details that you're baking in. And just because you're feeling it or enjoying listening or singing doesn't unfortunately translate into the listener enjoying it. So you kind of have to decide what gear you're in. Am I in a
Okay.
gear where this is for me, where this is healing for me, and I'm exploring and I'm feeling and I'm enjoying the sensations of singing? Or am I here showing up for the listener, which I'm going to do my best to serve the listener with my efforts. So I believe both of those things are really important, and different people require different amounts of each of them. But if you want to sound appealing to the listener, it can't just be you feeling great.
Okay.
There has to be some purposeful things you're baking in for the listener.
Wow. And I think that's, it's such a cool thing because that's too in everyday life. It's like, yes, we can do things that we enjoy and feel good, but it's really also about how it's received. And that's in every aspect, even relationship wise. It's such a balance, right? Because we want to feel the feels, but we also want to sound amazing. And that's y your gift. And I'm hoping that we're going to be able to carve out some time that you can do a little bit of singing if you're open to it.
Yeah,
A little
absolutely.
something.
Absolutely. But I want to take this opportunity to just really reiterate that those are two really different things.
Okay.
Singing to sound a certain way and singing to serve the audience is one thing, but it is completely okay and healthy. And I encourage people to do it for joy, for curiosity, for breath, for health, for stimulation. So even though you know, my job really is both of those things as a coach, is to meet people in whichever one of those camps they're most called by.
Okay. Something that you had said on stage, or something that you were sharing with us, maybe we can go there, is the different levels of voice. You were talking about how certain people talk up here and you went through it. And I loved that. If we can dive into just teach people a little bit about their voice and about their expression, I think that would be pretty powerful.
Well, would you agree that our voice is something so easy to take for granted?
I agree.
We use it every day. It does a pretty darn good job most of the time, barring a cold and flu, of connecting us to the people and things around us. So therefore, we don't really have to, which is really a beautiful gift, we don't really have to consider it all that much to still be a reasonably effective communicator. But if and when we are curious, there are certain observations that can shift how we see it and how we use it. So if you're someone who doesn't really have any issues with their voice, which is completely possible and great if you feel great in your voice, if you are someone who feels like that, then the exploration can simply be interesting.
Yeah.
But if you are someone who feels shy, perhaps, or like their voice fatigues frequently, or like they can't project the way they want to, or really a common one is like they sound annoying or something
yeah.
in this sphere, then sometimes it can be an interesting or healing exploration just to do a little look-see under the hood. Maybe you will end up wanting to shift something. You'll notice that there's a habit you've built, or maybe you'll simply find peace with exactly what you're doing. What I was talking about on stage that day is, because we use the voice so much, whatever habits we've built are pretty deeply ingrained.
Yeah.
So some people talk a little above or a little below what we could call their ideal range. You've got to keep in mind that the voice is an instrument in the same way that a saxophone is an instrument or a flute or a piano. It is a physical thing. When I coach, yes, these are my vocal cords.
Okay.
That I often use when I'm coaching. It is a physical instrument. So yours is shaped as it is shaped, and mine is shaped as it is shaped. And they're just like two different instruments side by side. They won't have the same capabilities. They won't have the same exact ranges or tones or shapes, sizes. So that being said, each of us kind of has a different ideal.
Okay.
A different safe zone. Maybe safe zone is a bit exaggerated. A different ideal place where things are working as smoothly as they possibly could. Did you ever play in band, a wind instrument?
I didn't.
You didn't?
I
well,
did.
If you've ever sat in a grade 6 band class where a bunch of, 11-year-olds?
12-year-olds? Yeah.
They all have these loud wind instruments. And they're all blowing into them with various force and various what we call embouchures. And you're going to hear lots of crazy sounds.
Yes.
Because they don't know yet how that exact instrument that's in their hand is meant to be played.
Love it.
And so we all, because talking is something we do, we're babies, we're toddlers, we make these sounds and we learn how to speak, make the shapes and sounds of our language. And as I said, it's usually enough. But
right,
the deep dive sometimes says, geez, I'll talk about myself. I'll use myself as an example.
Okay.
I'm a fairly excitable person.
Yes.
I'm a fairly tightly wound person. So if someone like me was to do a deep dive, it's often something you'll see that they're speaking slightly higher than their instrument might ideally be suited to. Just because when you get excited, sometimes things get up here a little bit, everything's a little bit up here. That can be fatiguing, because the one big difference between our voice and all the other instruments is that it's made of flesh and blood and human tissue.
Okay.
So you can play your saxophone with a funky embouchure and blow too hard, but it's made of steel. You know, it's going to be okay when the next person picks it up and blows on it differently. But our voice is of ourself. It's physical. It's made of us.
Yes.
So someone like me in the situation that I'm describing can end up kind of fatigued, kind of hoarse, kind of ouchy. So it takes someone, though, to either be very self-aware and look inside themselves, or for someone's choir teacher to say, yes, you're a great singer, but have you considered calming down your speech? And then maybe you'll stop complaining about how you're hoarse all the time. Mm. So it, in fact, you know, my choir teacher, bless her, brought to my attention that I might have been singing just fine, but that my speech was actually impeding my ability to sing because I was fatiguing my instrument.
Okay.
So the opposite of that, you know, some people do end up speaking lower than their range. And these things, by the way, speaking above your ideal range or below it, if done for short times, you know, if I was going to have like a sexy phone sex time.
Yes. Like person,
that's not going to break me, but it's these things. It's, you know, what a therapist might call repetitive strain.
Right? Okay.
A physiotherapist might call repetitive strain. So if it's something you're doing all the time, eventually your instrument gets pushed.
Yeah.
So for someone too, the issue that can cause this is various things too. When someone doesn't necessarily want to be heard, when someone it doesn't want to take up too much space, or be too loud, or be too, you know, pointy or obtuse, or isn't entirely sure of what they have to say. Sometimes people can end up. And both of them can be fatiguing. This is what you were asking about, I think.
Yes, this is exactly where I was going.
Yeah.
Because it's so much deeper than just like what you just nailed there. You're like, when you're talking like this, because it's maybe not wanting to be seen. This is huge. Okay, keep going. I love it.
Yeah, it can be. So again, if anybody out there is kind of like, oh, shoot, that's me, on either one of those fronts, it's okay. It's really okay. You're not broken, and it's shiftable. Cool. And even if you can't shift it, it's still okay. It's just there for the taking, is more my offering. It's there to look at if you want.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the ways that some people believe you can kind of find the center, if you will, of your voice is to say, uh-huh, as though someone is explaining to something and you're like, uh-huh, uh-huh.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, that feels kind of like a safe center for you.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. So I just go, uh-huh, uh-huh.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Okay, guys, do it too. You know you're doing it while you're listening to this.
Uh-huh, yeah, uh-huh. So the most relaxed and casual place, uh-huh. You know, we don't really think of the speaking voice as a pitched instrument, but realistically, we all have a bunch of notes, a range with which we speak. Male and female, we all have a bunch of notes. And for females, it tends to be more vast, right? Females are a little bit more expressive, and some of us even more so. Some of us are we're all over the place. Men tend to be a little bit more monotone. I mean, the term monotone specifically means one tone. So that's not maybe the most accurate way to say that, but men use less of a range. So they'll use less pitch variation. Whereas women will say, you wouldn't believe what happened to me. We use a lot more variation.
Yes.
But within that, there is definitely, you know, we can push the edges, just like in singing.
Yeah.
We can push the edges of that comfort zone. But for speaking, ideally you're kind of familiar with that warm place.
Yeah.
And honestly, if you're not experiencing any fatigue, or if you're not having any problems, great. Great. It's as simple as that. But if you're curious.
Yeah.
This. Yeah.
Crazy. So it makes a lot of sense. I have a question about men. So do you find that men try to talk deeper, like try to keep themselves?
Well, both men and women will manipulate themselves either on purpose or not. If you think about women who are trying to be dominant, trying to have people respect them, sometimes women can end up here, right?
Yeah.
No, you know, you hear, you can hear kind of in pop culture, men will be like, oh, women are such spazzes. so loud and spazzy. So women will end up going, I'm not a spaz. I am here to command the room. Sometimes, so women will sometimes lower their voice for that reason. Or when people feel sometimes like they're not being heard, sometimes they'll raise the pitch because that is
Louder.
actually, well, louder, but higher. So
Oh.
frequency-wise, the higher your voice is, the more it will cut through the din. Man or woman, right? The higher
Yeah.
pitch you use, the more you're going to cut through. So if you feel like you're not getting heard, or if you feel like the room is too loud or whatever, which is another common thing if you're working in a loud environment, like a, let's say, a restaurant or a club or a music venue, I mean, there's many different kinds of loud spaces. I mean, we also take for granted how decibel heavy some places are. The airport. Have you ever called someone from the airport and the person on the other line is like, "What is going on? I can't even hear what you're saying. There's
Yes.
announcements and there's people." We take for granted how many decibels are really happening around us.
So true.
So then we end up because it's kind of a fight or flight. Autonomic is what we would call it, an autonomic thing built into our head. We kind of know, even if you don't know this information, your body knows that in order to be heard, a higher pitch will cut through. A higher
Right.
pitch and pushing harder, louder, all the things. So if we feel as though we're not being heard, or if we feel as though there's loudness around us that we have to push through, we'll end up here all the time. We're trying to cut through all the time. And that can
Yes,
be fatiguing too. So
a
we're
hundred
often
percent.
responding and reacting to our environment. And we don't always have a choice, right? If you're at the airport, you're at the airport. So sometimes there's things that musicians have to deal with that can be helpful to people. For example, when we're on stage, we have either these monitors, they're called in-ear monitors, where I'm listening to myself. Are you listening to yourself?
I don't have my headset on, but I've listened. It's very cool. I love it.
Right, so we're monitoring the sound of our voice. So we either have these in, or we have a speaker on the stage that we call a monitor, which faces us, which plays ourself back to ourself and any other musicians on the stage. We get to hear a
Okay.
balanced variation of that. Now, why is that important to the average person? Well, if you're at the airport or in some loud environment where there's a lot of ambient noise happening, the tendency will be to shout. To get over
Right.
the din, but with
Okay.
the awareness that I can't hear myself well, so my body's reaction is going to want to be to shout. I don't want to hurt my voice, so I'm going to do what? Well, I'm going to get closer to people when I'm talking. Well, I'm
Right.
also going to have an awareness that, well, my voice is getting tired and fatigued. So even though my body is calling for me to shout so that I can be heard, I'm going to keep in mind that it is also other people's responsibility to hear me. Not just my responsibility to put myself to bleed myself so that
That's
I am
right.
heard.
So
So
good.
we have to sometimes fight that natural urge to be heard at all costs and shift our environment, come close to people, make those shifts. So again, as a musician, if we don't have these, this is something very difficult for people to understand. And when I was a very young musician, it really blew my mind. People would say, "Can we have you play this gig, but there's no monitor?" And I would be like, "That's fine. I don't need a monitor. I'm loud. I can do what I can do." But that's how we hurt ourselves as a musician. That's how we hurt ourselves. So when singers come to me and say that their voice is hoarse and band practice is awful and it's not working out and they can only get through half their show, the first thing I always want to talk about is how are they hearing themselves? And again, that translates to everyday life. So any issues you're having vocally, you got to look around at your environment and how you're responding to
You're like the vocalist whisperer. I'm serious, 'cause it's whoever knew, like I didn't even know this, something like this was out there until I met you, and I was like, this makes so much sense. And when you were talking about raising our voice and lowering it, for example, my son, he's six, and at times I don't ever want to yell, like I don't operate in that realm. But of course, like you just said, I'll be like, Cassius. And he's like, why are you yelling at me? And because I don't yell, but I'm raised my voice. Kids are so sensitive, their ears. And I'm paying attention to it now. And especially with what you're saying, because I'm like, well, to him, that's yelling
Oh,
because I'm operating at a higher, de what, decibel frequency.
just loud, you're just loud. Absolutely. And I think too, you know, we are really sensitive to the way we communicate with each other. There's so many micro details that communicate to us or have us say, is this person upset? Is this person frustrated? Is this person joyful? Are we being playful? There are so many details in the voice. And actually that fascinates me. And the reason it does is because of music. When I'm trying to figure out, you know, explain to someone how to sing something in a way that is more emotive, more evocative, we always look to speech. We look to speech and see what are the details. What does a kid do when they're crying like this and they're just telling you about their bad day? Well, what does Billie Eilish do? Take it, try. It's really related. So why, when we hear Billie Eilish, do we go, oh God, there's a lump in my throat? Well, naturally, in the human experience, we recognize that sound. That's my belief. That's my belief.
That's so good, Jen.
So when we want singing to feel emotive, well, what do? In speech, because we could borrow it. So we have one voice. We have one voice, and it can be all the details we use in our day-to-day life can and should be extrapolated into music.
Mic drop.
Yeah.
Wow, and I love how you're saying borrowing. Like, yes, that's exactly what she's doing. She's just tapping into that.
Well, and think about too, if someone is impassionate and saying, I can't believe this happened. I can't believe. Or, I can't believe it's happening. I can't believe. It's all packaged in there, right? It's all packaged in there. So the people who become very vocally able as far as singing goes are people who are very tapped into and playful and are accessing easily all of the emotions that they use, that we as humans use in speech. Because we all know, you know, people say, oh, I can't sing like that. I can't belt like that. I can't do that. And my answer is always, yes, you can. Usually the question I ask is, have you ever yelled at your dog? Have you ever yelled at your kid? Have you ever yelled, you know, shouted to get your friend's attention when they were across the street or across a busy room? Well, then yes, you can. If you can raise your voice, then yes, you can. But people, the divide is, well, I can talk like that, but that has nothing to do with singing. It's, we only have one voice. There is no singing voice and talking voice.
I love this. Because I was going to say, remember I was going to say before we started recording, I was like, so my thing was Whitney Houston and I Will Always Love You, period. Exclamation. That was my jam. So I would sit in front of, the mirror and I'd look at myself and over and over and then just lose it. Just lose it. I was going to be a singing dentist. That was the MO. That's what I wanted to be. And I danced as well. And so I had the microphone, I had the Spice Girls, I had Whitney, you name it, all of it, just like what you were talking about. I'm like, I love this. And it was like, I just wanted to do nothing more but to sing. And it was great because when you were talking about how our voice goes up and down and how you were teaching us to talk and sing opposed to go like out of our talking voice, it was so powerful. Cause I was like, I would do that. I would just lose it. And there would be like maybe one, what do you call it? A vocal or one frequency that I felt sounded okay. And then the rest was just out the window.
But you have a lovely speaking voice, you know, to be clear. I mean, the fact that you ended up as a coach and a podcaster and all these things doesn't surprise me either. I mean, to talk to everybody out there, barring some crappy medical luck, most of us are pretty capable.
Right.
Of using our voice well and communicating in a way that feels really authentic to you, the speaker, and receiving it as the listener. We're mostly quite capable. Just like anything in the body, we are creatures of habit.
Yeah.
So if you've made a habit at a young age of not taking up space with your voice, you will have created all sorts of shortcuts to make sure that you're not ever too loud or too bold or too high or too anything.
You
And
got
then you
it.
end up, when you come to singing, it feels extremely overwhelming to suddenly need volume, need high notes, need big, bold sounds. So
Wow.
speaking is so relevant, is so relevant.
I have a question. So when there's a couple things. So when I would sing, or there's certain parts that I'll still sing. I won't ever not sing in my home and in my car and in front of my son. There are moments it
You won't
hurts.
sing in front of your son?
No, I said, or in front of him.
You
I
will, you
will.
will, you will, you
Yes.
will, you will.
We do it together. Like we dance,
Good.
we sing, we are just a pair. It's great.
Yes.
So when I sing, I'll sing something and then it will hurt, because it's like, I'm like, why can't I just, sometimes it's like let go, or like if you're singing a certain part. So I was going to ask you, what is that? If it hurts.
Yeah, we definitely don't want it to hurt. We
It
definitely don't want it
hurts
to hurt. But after.
after. And sometimes if I've done it a couple of times, yeah, on certain parts.
Are you the type that when you go to a concert, you cheer a lot, a lot, a lot, a lot, and sing along and just lose it at a concert? Yeah.
At moments.
Have you ever done it so much that after you wake up the next day and you're like, ooh,
Yep, I have
ooh.
done that.
Well, that's the same thing you're describing
Okay.
with singing. So whether, yes, could there be some tension? Tension is a funny word that I always use with caution when I'm coaching, because typically the word tension has lots of negative association. Well, I must have tension in my neck, or tension in my jaw, or tension in my tongue, or tension in some of these muscles. And that's very possible, and it's very possible that that's causing issues. But I guess I always want to remind people that when we're singing, muscles are adjusting our vocal cords to different thicknesses and lengths. And if you think about what happens when a muscle has to do its job, you could call that tension, right? When I yank on, these are my muscles, and I'm
Yeah.
pulling on my vocal cords, well, I am creating some tension. So
Yeah.
the only reason I'm going on this tangent is because I think that people hear this word tension, they go, that's me. I must have tension. I have tension, I have
Okay.
tension, I have tension, I'm broken, I have all this tension. Now, we do. I mean, I don't know how much to overshare to these poor listeners, but
Beautiful listeners.
how I always relate to people. So let's say there is some tension for you.
Yeah.
Let's say when you're making these big sounds, there are some muscles that you're activating that you don't need, but habitually you just keep activating them. But if I said to you, you've got some tension in your jaw, or you've got some tension in your tongue, or you've got some tension here or there, your response in your mind's eye would be, no, I don't. I swear, I'm loose. I've loosened everything I can.
Yeah.
So, I'll give the example of my pelvic floor,
Oh.
which I went and I was saying, I'm having these symptoms, so I went to see a pelvic floor therapist, and what she told me, and this made me cry and cry and cry, but I eventually realized what a beautiful lesson it was as far as my
Okay.
coaching went. She explained to me that I essentially was, for lack of a better word, doing a Kegel at ground zero. So when I believe I am relaxed,
Okay, you just chill.
I'm chill, I'm Kegeling.
Wow.
So that tension I am unaware of. So in order for me to release that tension, I have to tap in, really, really tap in order to release it, because
Oh,
my
okay.
brain has decided that that's relaxed. This is relaxed. I'm as relaxed. So that's what happens when people go to sing or speak, or our pelvis. There's lots of connections. Many people see a lot of connections between like
Yes.
pelvis. So
The
it's
jewels.
jewels. It's an apt comparison. Yes. So
It's true.
a lot of singers will say, I don't have tension. Huh, I'm relaxed. I'm relaxed. But as soon as I hear them or see them saying, I'm like, you're not. But I know that you believe you are, and I understand that, and this is why.
I
I
love that.
always, yes, when I feel someone's frustration, when I'm trying to explain to them that maybe there is some tension or something they're holding on to, I understand how much it can feel like it doesn't, like it's not a problem. As I said, I can be relaxed in the tub, as relaxed as possible, but I have to go very, very mentally inward to relax that. So that is the same practice because, as I said, muscle memory. My muscle memory has decided that that is neutral.
That's your normal.
That's my normal. And that's a lot of people when they go to sing, they've been singing a certain way for so many years, maybe speaking, but sometimes just singing when they go to their singing mode, because you don't have tension in speech, you would agree, right? You don't.
I don't think, no.
Yeah, it feels very relaxed. So
It's singing.
when you go to singing, that means that you've built some sort of muscle memory. There's some sort of activation that you tend to do that
Okay.
you might not need, but it doesn't feel like you're squishing something you don't need to squish because you've always squished it.
That's
So it
right.
feels neutral to you. Now, on top of that, if we'll talk more about you, as I was talking about at a loud concert, our instrument again is made of flesh and
Yeah.
bone. So unlike a saxophone that's steel that you can play and play and play and play and play, you
Yeah.
can literally, at IKEA where they have that machine that sits on the chair all day.
Yes. Oh my.
Okay, so that chair is gonna wear out eventually, but it can take a lot. Same with a saxophone. You could do the same IKEA machine and have something blowing into a saxophone. Yeah, the reed might, fatigue, but the instrument's going to be fine.
Yeah.
Whereas we don't have the luxury of metal, steel. We are made of more delicate tissues.
Yeah.
So if you're using your voice for a long time in an aggressive way, yeah, you're allowed to feel it. It would actually be quite crazy. It would be like someone saying to me, well, I did chin-ups or pull-ups for 3 hours and now I don't understand, my arms hurt.
Okay.
Well, yeah, they do. You
I
did a
hope
million
so.
pull-ups. Yes.
I hope so.
Yes. So, I think people have it in their head that if they make sound and then they feel something, they've done something wrong. And it's possible, I don't, a wrong is kind of a, I don't know if that's a super helpful term because the sound we're making is the sound we're making.
Yeah.
But if you're looking for longevity, or in your case where you're like, I sing and I'm having fun, and then like it feels like something, I did too much.
Yeah.
Well, you probably did too much.
Yeah.
You probably did too much. Could be a combination of some tension that's making you not be able to sustain as long, right? What I was describing with my pelvic floor. If there's something that you're holding on to that you're unaware of, that can be part of it. But also, if you yell for a prolonged amount of time, does it not make sense that you would fatigue?
Yep. It does.
And singing is yelling.
Right.
So we can learn how to use our instrument as well as we can, just like working out. You can lift weights with good technique and you can lift weights with bad technique.
Yeah.
And you lifted weights both ways, but
Yeah, it's like longevity. It's like life. Your body's going to be here till we're 80, so of course we want to lift it the right way, that's not going to harm us. Same with this, right?
Yes, but I also don't want people to be afraid to explore.
Okay.
However, if you are constantly, I don't know if you said, is this a constant for you?
Well, now that we're talking about it, it's like it makes sense because if I'm not singing all the time, I'm not using those certain levels very often or that often. So it's like when I do it, I'm doing it more than I typically would. So it's kind of making sense. But at the same
Well,
time, there's definitely tension because I can feel myself holding back when I'm trying to just like sing.
yes, to what you just said. That, sorry, I'm really, really glad you
Yes.
said that.
Okay.
What you just said is so relevant.
Okay.
W People holding back when they're singing is the most prominent and
Okay.
annoying and fatiguing kind of tension there could be. I'm so glad you said that. All
Okay, good.
everything else I said is mildly relevant, but not half as relevant as what you just said.
Okay.
Holding back is tension.
Yeah.
How much tension would it take if a horse was trying to run and you were like, but not quite so much running, and you tried to hold, you know, push it back. That takes a lot of energy, a lot of muscle flexion. We'll call it tension, a lot of activation. Sometimes it takes a lot more energy to do less. As a matter of fact, the most prized coloratura opera singers, one of the things they are prized for is to be able to sing very, very high, very, very quiet, because it takes a lot of activation to hold back. So when singers are holding back, when they don't even need to, it's like, oh, that's disappointing. Oh, that's frustrating for you. I want you to be able to be completely forward motion and experience yourself fully. That skill that it takes to start shaping the sound and shifting the volume and shifting the velocity and the tension and whatever you want to call it, that's not necessary out the gate. I really firmly believe that it serves people best to find freedom first. The rest of the shaping can come. But
Okay.
it's a lot harder to take someone teeny weeny and afraid and holding back and always trying to be pull more. I encourage everybody to look for freedom first.
Like mic drop again. This everything you're talking about, especially throat. I'm wearing blue. That's like throat chakra energy color anyways. This is cool. It's like the exact same thing in life. It's like, where are we holding back in life? Same. It's like holding back in your voice or your singing.
Again,
it's so true.
The way we do something is often the way we do everything. So circling back to my funny pelvic floor analogy, that is this tension that I'm unaware of. Well, that feels relevant in my world.
Yeah.
So, you know, I had several years ago now, I had a really nasty bout of TMJ, temporomandibular disorder.
Okay.
I'm sure many people out there have experienced this, where some of the muscles in your jaw freak out.
Yeah.
And they're in spasm. And I went to dentists and I went to chiropractors and I had people reefing on it and pushing on it and creating me a stupid mouth guard. And then the other dentist says, that's the wrong mouth guard.
Oh my God.
I remember Christmas dinner that year. I could fit both my fingers in my mouth with my jaw as closed as I could get it. It was so painful. I couldn't chew. I couldn't eat.
Oh.
At the end of the day, how did I heal this? Well, it wasn't the dentists and it wasn't the chiropractors and it wasn't the muscle relaxants. It was the yellow sticky note that I wrote and put on my computer screen where I work and my mirror where I do my makeup and my bedroom where I turn off the light that said, relax your jaw.
Wow.
Relax your jaw. Because many people have jaw tension when they sleep, right? You know, people who grind their teeth.
Yeah.
Well, some people clench their jaw in the day. Some people are just tense people. I'm a tense person. I'm very tightly wound. And that's something I used to be very self-conscious about. You know, when I, in dating, men would say, gosh, you're a lot, or you're really, ugh. And I used to be like, God, I just need to be cooler. Like, I just got to relax and be cooler. But my personality functions because of that tightened everything.
Yeah.
So as most things in life, there's a duality. There's
yeah.
a duality. So that high strungness is why I'm an effective and exciting coach.
Yeah.
But it is also why I'm Kegeling 24/7 and why my jaw got stuck.
I'm so, like, it's not to be inappropriate, but it's not the worst thing in the world.
You would say that. You would say that, but it is just as crappy as women who have the opposite.
Okay,
where their,
makes
like,
sense.
Pee is leaking out.
Yeah.
It's the same thing, like, it can be painful, right?
If you think yeah, it, no. That makes sense.
Yeah. So anything that's out of whack, one way or the other, too high, too low, too tense, too loose.
Yeah.
The body is such an equilibrium, right? We're looking for that homeostasis. Yes, yes.
Yes.
But whatever our personal imbalances are, usually have a pro and a con, is all I'm
you
saying.
Got it.
So finding that relaxation is how I healed my jaw tension by constant, I mean, you know, and also relaxing it and massaging it, but reminding ourselves when we're singing, when we're kegeling, when we're whatever it is that we're doing, is this actually as relaxed as I exist, can possibly exist? Or is there something underneath there that I'm so used to doing that I'm not even aware it's there? So when people go to sing, whether you're trying to protect yourself from being too loud or from being heard or from cracking or from, there's just like a myriad, you know, somebody said to me, well, my quiet, I have so many stories like this. My teacher in grade six told me, oh gosh, you're so out of tune, just mouth the words.
Oh my gosh.
So many adults have stories like this. Well, you know, my ex-husband told me, ugh, he heard me singing in the shower and he told me to stop.
Yeah.
You know, both men and women, both men and women. So we have all of this, these crazy programs that our bodies have set up to protect us. So we have to really dig around to find sometimes stuff that's very obvious to someone like me.
Yeah.
Right? So, so for someone like you, this is what I would assign you as an exploration.
Okay.
Are you, you said you love Whitney Houston, I Will Always Love You. So I assume the singing you're doing is like the powerful, exciting, bold stuff.
So it's, you know, when she does the drop and you just go for it.
Yes.
Or like there's certain parts to songs that I like to do that, but it's a very short window until the voice cracks and goes where I'm just like, and cut. And then I'm just like voicing it or mouthing it.
Okay. Okay. So what I will assign to you is,
okay,
as someone who I hear is a good voice user, a good, confident public speaker, because that's what we're doing right now, even though it's just the two of us, this is public speaking.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Most people are public speakers. Most people are, if they really look at their life.
Truth.
I would guess that you would feel pretty confident about just yelling. I don't mean screaming. I don't mean anything special. I just mean raising your voice to be heard.
Right.
Or raising your voice out of emotion.
Yes.
Fear, anger, grief, joy, any of those things.
Yeah.
So your job is to remember what that feels like and connect it. Keep that feeling as you transition into music. So one of the really most helpful exercises that I give to people, if they're brave enough to do it, because that's a lot of stuff when it comes to vocal coaching, is we often ask people to make sounds that are, quote, silly.
Yeah.
And we don't do it for any other reason than everything is an exploration and an unraveling.
Totally.
So something that, if you can do this kind of exercise, hey, hey, hey,
hey, hey, and move my arms even? Or is that
sometimes,
just
sometimes? No, okay. No. Sometimes it's really helpful to connect the body to that movement.
Hey, hey.
Now you're going to do it again, and you're going to, every time you do the hey, you're going to try and lift it up just a little bit higher, just a little bit of a
at
higher
the end.
Note.
Hey,
or the whole thing. Yes, but the whole thing. You're going to start low, and the whole reason we're starting low is because that's our comfort zone. Hey, yeah, whoa, hey, I'm good here.
Hey, yeah, ho.
So
hey.
Yes, you're going to always start low. You're going to travel and scoop upwards to a higher and higher place. But the key is to not what we call break, meaning this, hey, or hey, where we end up in this soft place. We've tricked ourselves.
That's what happens.
We're not yelling. Okay.
We're not doing that.
So, don't go any higher than you can stay connected.
Okay.
I don't care if it's not high.
Hey, hey. Can you say it again for me?
Hey, hey,
hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey.
Okay, so challenge yourself. Push it up. Take the end up higher.
Hey, hey.
Higher.
Hey.
Yes, higher.
I was yelling.
Yes, it is yelling. Go.
Hey.
No, that's breaking. So that broke.
Hey. That broke.
So your assignment, your journey, if you choose to take it.
Yes, I'm doing it.
Is to stick with this exercise and keep the word freedom in your head and heart. Okay. Keep the feeling of This is your voice. This is your space. This is your life. This is your air. This is your energy.
Okay.
So if you can accept that you're allowed
Yeah.
to make whatever sound you want to make and be however loud you need to be, and to crack your voice if you need to crack your voice, to figure out what you need to do to not crack your voice. Permission, permission, permission. You're
Okay.
going to start on this low note and you're going to scoop up and not be in a hurry to get to high notes, but
Okay.
also accept when you said, well, but I was just yelling. Yes, that is what this is. This is
Hey.
us connecting with yelling, but we're also marrying it with music because we're sliding through these pitches. That's all music is a bunch of
Yeah.
different pitches, right? All we're doing
Love
is sliding through different notes. So this gives your body the opportunity to start merging the way you use your voice every day and setting a purpose. Because when we speak, there is no assigned pitches, right? If I say to you, hey, how are you? Or hey, how are you? You still get it.
Yeah.
You still understand. So it doesn't matter if I say, hey, how are you? The words are still there. So we don't speak with assigned pitches. That is the difference between singing and speaking is we have to hit these pitches. We
That's
have
right.
to. So this is a way for you to merge the comfort you have in your everyday speaking, yelling, talking, whispering, whatever it is you do, and this thing, this mysterious thing we call singing that we often think, well, I can't just do this over here. This is some special thing. This exercise allows you to to start to realize, okay, I can play with pitches, but I am also talking and yelling, but I am also doing this pitch thing. Okay. So your job is to stay in the fullest place in your voice. Hey. Now, I'm very, very well versed in using those thick, yelly places in my voice. So to anybody out there listening, and to you too, do not have the expectation that you're going up there. But your job, it's most important, yes, slide up, but find the balance between the place where you're able to stay in the full place in your voice and not break up into hey, but you do have to push yourself. Right? If you just say, hey, you have to challenge yourself. So if you, as you're sliding up and up and up, if you find that you break, okay, so that's my limit right now of where I can't figure out how to relax. Because say this, try this. Hey, how are you? That's yelling. That is full. That is thick. If that translated into singing, you would be doing Whitney Houston. That
Hey, how are
is,
you?
that's
Yes.
low. That's
Okay.
more of a speech.
Hey, how are you?
Hey!
Oh,
Perfect. So you just did the exercise. That's the apex of the exercise.
hey.
Let's see where that was. Hey! Try this. Hey!
Hey.
Push it a little bit more. Hey!
Hey.
Yes, excellent.
Hey.
Let's try one more note. Use your arm if you want. Let's go. Hey!
Hey.
Good. Try one more. Try not to break. Really lean in. Permission, permission.
Hey.
Hey!
Hey.
There you go. Okay,
Okay,
so
so
that is
I felt that push. Hey, like I was,
good.
it's okay to yell.
It is not only okay, it is ultimately necessary.
Okay.
Ultimately necessary. Now you heyed yourself up to a B. That B is right below the C that Adele, Pink, Kelly Clarkson, Carrie Underwood, blah, 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 blah. That C and that B, to some degree, the B that you just used is that sparkly note. That's the place where singers start to really tug on people's emotions,
Right.
is that area. If you want, we can try and achieve the C. We'll try, we'll try. So start really low and safe. Use your body, use your arms, throw yourself into this, and remember that your body knows how to do this. It's made this sound before. This is not
Yeah.
the first time you'll have made this sound. This
Yeah.
is the first time you'll have made it with like the purpose that we have right now, but your body has made this. So this is not novel. It's
Yeah.
not novel. So you're going to say, hey!
Hey.
And that's a C. That's a C. So that would be like,
So go up higher then.
no, that's it. You did it. That probably is. And I Right, that note, I would have to check the Whitney Houston song where it sits, but it's highly possible that it
Wow.
could be that C. So this is just a remembering. Singing is
Okay.
a remembering of
Yes.
how speaking and yelling and talking and crying and cracking and all of the sounds that we make in our day-to-day life, singing is the permission you're giving itself to bring all those raw things, those raw emotional things, and then use them with purpose and use them in a way that is not just for you and your own emotion, but helps other people feel their emotion too. So it's harnessing those emotions from speech and day-to-day life
Yeah.
with purposeful notes behind them.
Like even just doing whatever we did, that hey, and like really doing the hey and pushing through, I felt something let go. It was wild. And I even feel emotion in my heart.
Yes, because my friend, that's that sound that you made today is familiar to you. It is all yours. It is something you've done since your youth, but it is something, especially as adults, we are like, well, you know, we're proper. We don't yell and we don't. So it is a welcoming back to yourself. That is already yours. It is just permission to use it.
Even when I saw you on stage, I was like, I'm calling it in to be able to work with you, because it's unlocking so much more. And everybody that's watching and listening, this isn't just about singing. This is so much deeper. This is where we've cut off our throat chakra, where we've been scared to speak our truth, where we've been shunned, where we've been told that we weren't pretty enough, good enough, could sing, could dance. What you're doing, Jen, is so, so, so much more. Like, I'm so
I'm
grateful.
So glad. I'm so glad you receive it that way. And that's what I will leave people with, is that whether singing interests you specifically, like you've always wanted to do it, that's great. That is a perfect reason to lean into singing. But even if you have no desire to step on stage, I would say that most humans would be hard pressed to say that they don't enjoy singing. There's just no way.
There's no
way.
Most
people love it.
Yeah.
Look at toddlers. You know, all my friends, I don't have kids. I don't want kids. But
and that's okay.
Many, many women in my life have kids. And every one of them comes to me with this. They're like, you're never going to believe it. My kid loves singing. And I'm always like, you don't say, because it's the human experience. Toddlers are the prime example of little humans that don't give a fuck. They don't give a fuck. So they don't have yet the like, oh, I don't want to take up too much space. Oh, it's quiet time. Oh, this isn't appropriate. Oh, my voice might crack. They don't care. A five-year-old girl will spin in the middle of the living room in her party dress, singing along to songs with such sheer joy, enthusiasm, and freedom. That 5-year-old is where I want people to take themselves and remember how that felt.
Yeah.
Remember how it felt to be 5 years old in kindergarten, singing, watching TV in your living room, in your safe space, making that sound. Because that still lives in every one of us. Every one of us.
You
and
got
it is joyful as F to go
Fuck
there.
Yes.
So whether you want to sing because you literally want to sing and you want to get from A to B and you want to get on stage or you want to write a song or you want to whatever, that's fine to have those goals. But it's also fine to just be like, I want to be in my body. I want to use my body to the extent to which it was designed.
Yes.
It's okay to want to sing just because it feels so goddamn good.
So powerful, Jen. Oh my God. I'm looking at the time. I know we have to wrap up really quickly here. Is there just a little bit of space to sing a little bit? You've done a little bit, but like, just if you don't, I respect it, but.
Oh no, sure.
A little something.
Pull up.
You know what? You guys, everybody listening, you have released a song and it's amazing because it's I Want to Dance with Somebody.
Oh yeah, the Whitney Houston song. Yeah, that was really fun. I got to collaborate with a producer in the States, he approached me on Instagram,
Yeah.
and so we created that song. But there's, yeah, please do look up Rozette, Rozette on Spotify or Apple or wherever you
And TikTok,
stream music.
we didn't even get to talk about that, but we'll come back. I'm wanting to have you on the show again
Well,
because
I'm so sorry I preached and preached. I'm just so passionate about people
don't be sorry.
being in their body. And I really hope, to anybody listening too, I'm going to be transitioning from one-on-one coaching to creating a membership community myself where we get to riff on this stuff together. And I'm going to have hot seat coaching where people can come make some noise and be witnessed by me and everybody and get some coaching. So
Okay, I
please
love
watch for
that.
that. Please do
Yes.
have me back. I'd love to come talk about that.
Yep, you're coming back. It's already done. It's a
Okay.
non-negotiable. Let's hear you,
Okay,
Mama.
here it is. That Arizona sky burning in your eyes. You look at me, babe, I wanna catch on fire. It's buried in my soul, like California gold. You found the light in me that I couldn't find. So when I'm all choked up, but I can't find the words. Every time we say goodbye, hurts. When the sun goes down won't play, I'll always remember.
Wow. Amazing. That
Thanks.
went to my soul. You are such a beautiful soul, Jen. I'm so grateful for you and reconnecting and having you on the show.
Well, I want to say to you, thank you for approaching me to do this because I am in such a place of shifting and changing right now, and realizing that as a coach, I am so passionate about sharing this with people and letting them experience themselves fully. But what I'm coming into is needing to reconnect with my own joy and how I want to share this information and how I want to celebrate it with people. So thank you for holding me to making time to do this, which is really where a lot of my joy lives. So thank you for making space and holding me gently to booking this with you,
Oh,
because it's
yeah.
very, very easy for me to say I have nothing left.
Yeah.
So what this forced me to do was prioritize something I wanted to do over top of coaching and coaching my little life away. So thank
Yeah.
you.
Oh. My pleasure. I see you and so grateful. Quickly, we're going to pull you a card how we end the show. So you get a little message, something for your highest and best good always coming through from your beautiful spirit team and the beautiful angels. So any message that needs to come through for Jen's highest and best good, I just let the cards fall out. I have full surrender to the energy. Any and all message that needs to come through, I let it come through. And you know that song that you're singing, and you know how I said my loved one who had passed, that's a song that I put on a lot of our on a lot
Oh
of the
gosh.
stories. So it just was like,
Oh
I was
wow.
just like, that was came through from him for sure. Okay. 10 of Ariel. And it says, there is so much to be grateful for: financial success and the promise of retirement, a rich and rewarding family life. And if you look at this photo, they are just look at there's Paris, there's the Eiffel Tower, and they are just basking and having such a good time and have no worries about your future.
Oh,
Everything. You are so held, and everything is going to be a beautiful, just an integration into your next endeavor. And I'm going to send you the write-up for this too, because there's always deeper messages.
please do. It's of interest.
Yes, this is a beautiful card to receive, and really just remembering tapping into your heart, receiving, and being grateful. Just that grateful energy brings us into that shift. And I do that as much as I can because it's easy. We get caught up and you're busy and you're a performer and you're on stage and you're sharing your bright light. But we can't forget about you. You need to receive too.
Well, thank you. I'm going to be working on that in the coming months in a big, bold way. So thank yes. you for kicking it off so beautifully.
Absolutely. Thank you for your time. And we will see you back on the show soon.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes.